It is that time of the year where the thoughts of cycling fans turn to the biggest races of the season, the Tour de France.
And this year, there's not just one Tour de France, but two. The whole of July is going to be filled with bike racing at its finest, with the Tour de France Homme and then the Tour de France Femme avec Zwift.
And so we are delighted to be joining up with the Tour de France Club to bring you a show that builds up to the biggest month in cycling. We're going to be looking back at some of the key races that have got us to this point in the season.
We'll then speak to Tour de France race directors Christian Prudhomme and Marion, asking them the questions that you wanted answered as we turn our attention to the most prestigious events in our sport.
Before we crack on though, we've got an offer for everyone out there. There are many benefits to becoming a Tour de France club member, which we'll get onto later on, but the new benefit is that all club members based in 14 specific markets will be able to take advantage of a 25% discount code for GCN Plus.
On top of that, we've also been working together with the Tour de France on a special clothing collaboration with some limited edition hoodies and t-shirts, two of which Dan and I are wearing now.
I'm very pleased with them, yeah, but they would look even better on you at home, I'm sure. Now, if you'd like to buy one, all you need to do is head to shop.globalcyclingnetwork.com. Right then, first up, let's remind ourselves of what's happened so far in 2022.
What a day, what a time trial, a team time trial. Laporte, Van Aert and Roglic.
C'est sixième étape, ça revient très vite avec Mats Pedersen. Résistez jusqu'au bout. La ligne arrive. C'est fait. Victoire de Mathieu Burgodo.
There's no one who can live with him. Primož Roglič is away. Primož Roglič is going to take his first victory of the season. But Simon Yates rides away to glory. A tremendous attack. Gets his reward. Roglič does it. He wins Paris-Nice. There's no repeat of the Rog final day collapse.
Vincendo la seconda edizione della Parigi-Roubaix dopo un'azione da sogno, da capolavoro, è tutto tuo il velodromo, Elisa, è tutto tuo!
Solo, on his own, the job done. Dylan van Baarle, it's all yours. It's going to be a drag race to the line between these two riders. Marta Cavalli takes it.
Alejandro Valverde's got the finish, but can he get around Dylan Teuns? Dylan Teuns has got just enough. Dylan Teuns is the winner of the 86th edition of La Flèche Wallonne. What a finale.
Huge attack again as Annemiek van Vleuten turns it up another notch, gets out of the saddle and finds something extra.
Annemiek van Vleuten, who comes through to take her second career victory here in Liège-Bastogne-Liège. Remco Evenepoel with 29 kilometres remaining, and that is a ferocious acceleration, and he's flying here. Belgium is about to go bananas. Remco Evenepoel, at the first time of asking, wins Liège-Bastogne-Liège.
I do love a montage of bike racing, I've got to say. There's been some exceptional racing already this season, including Van Vleuten and Evenepoel's dominance at Liège-Bastogne-Liège, and further solo victories for Longo Borghini and Van Baarle at Paris-Roubaix.
At the early season stage races, it felt like it was business as usual for Primož Roglič at Paris-Nice, despite it being his first overall win at the race. Then it all came undone on the roads of the Tour of the Basque Country.
Which was the first time in a long time that we've seen Roglic unable to compete with the best without having had any bad luck or crashes. But then it transpired that this was down to a niggling knee injury.
A knee injury meant he didn't compete again until the Critérium de Dauphiné, so there were a few question marks over his form. At least there were at the start.
See, it's time to pick it up. Well out, Gottfried. Ethan Hayter on the barriers at the moment. Stoyman, it's a 1-2-3 for the time being. Is it well? It's going to get it on the throw, and I think it is. He gets there. Oh, my goodness. Olli Ligac is out in front, he's going to get there. Three at the throw, it's all between them. And it's all for that man. Alexis Fiamos helps himself.
Here is our glorious leader, and he has taken the lead of this race.
And here we are, there's the yellow jersey, and it's going to be transferring, and possibly onto the shoulders of Wout van Aert. Van Aert in the green jersey, as he made amends right at the very last. Oh, ooh, did he get on the throw? Godou pinched it from him. Too much celebration, and Godou it was.
Yes!
And here comes Van Aert, And there it is, gone green for you at the moment. Will the clock go red? It's very, very tight indeed. 3, 2, 1, it's a red on Van Aert. He does not take the time trial. Garner, happy that he did the job. This is touch and go. This is absolutely fantastic. Oh my life, they've been found out again. Is he going to get there? Or is he going to have his heart broken at the very last? And all of a sudden, the complexion changes entirely. Oh, well, Van Aert throws the bike. Van Aert gets there. My life, that was so, so close. That's going to be an X out, I'm afraid.
Yep.
If they see that, you cannot hit somebody on the head. That's crossed arms straight up, and he'll be out of the race. Baggioli now is a straight-up race between those, but it may be for minor places, and it is. Ferron has the day. Stage 7 is too much. He's put in a lot to this race. He's got half a minute, but what else he got left? I think this is the cruelty of the whole thing. It's going to be heartbreak. You're absolutely right. He's got to get around these last couple of hundred metres and bring it home from the breakaway yet again. 50 metres, he's going to get there. Carlos Ferona, chapeau to that man. Here comes Roglic. He wants bonus seconds, but he wants a gap as well on everybody else. Finger go, 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 go. They're trying to shake off O'Connor at the moment. Go on, let's hold hands. As they cross the line, it will be Finger go takes the stage and Roglic takes the title.
That is what you call a demonstration. Jumbo-Visma took 3 stage wins, the yellow jersey with Roglic, second on GC with Vingegaard, the green jersey with Van Aert, and the team's classifications to boot.
Not bad, is it? And in a parallel universe, Van Aert could conceivably have won the first 4 stages of that race in a row, I reckon. And now this, of course, bodes very well for the Tour de France for Jumbo-Visma. Well, they will take aim at winning both the yellow and green jerseys, which is a lofty ambition, especially given that they've not won either of those jerseys outright so far.
And if they go in with a 2-pronged GC attack, that means they'll have 3 protected leaders, which in turn means that the other 5 riders on that team can have a lot of work to do in July.
True. I do not envy those 5 riders, I must admit. Now, whilst they couldn't really have done much better at the Criterium du Dauphiné, there's also not a huge amount that you can conclude from that race, because Ineos sent their A team to the Tour de Suisse, which they won overall with Geraint Thomas, whilst Pogacar went to and won the Tour of Slovenia.
Felt like the only thing he didn't win there was a game of rock, paper, scissors with teammate Rafał Majka that they used to decide who would win the stage.
It was bizarre, wasn't it? Yeah. However, whilst it would be nice to see the big guns going head-to-head more often in the early season, it does leave us with the tantalising prospect of seeing how they compare once they arrive in Copenhagen for Le Grand Depart on Friday the 1st of July. Now, before we look ahead to this year's Tour de France, let's take a look back at highlights from 12 months ago.
A supporter.
Tony Martin.
Oh no.
It's taken out.
Julien Alaphilippe makes the first move of this tour. He's done it. He's pulled it off. France has its hero back. And Julien Alaphilippe proving once again that yellow is his favourite colour of the rainbow.
It had to be a classy rider that would win it at the end of the day. And there's none bigger than this man.
Who are you thinking of when you cross the line?
Michael Kandil, of course.
It's Roglic who's down, and you can see them all on the radio. Oh, what a disaster this is for Jumbo-Visma today. It's Menlier. It's another win for Alpecin Fenix on one of the most chaotic days we have ever seen at the Tour de France.
Mark Cavendish is going to do it! Oh, he's done it! What drama, and what a winner!
So many people didn't believe in me, you know, and these guys do.
He's going to win the stage. The Tour de France defence is on for Tadej Pogacar.
And now we're allowing ourselves to believe in the record.
Matej Mohoric makes Bahrain victorious.
Tadej Pogacar is asking the question, either you ride with me or I'm going to attack you and drop you.
Brilliant work, Dylan Teuns. Super job. What is left to say about this man, apart from chapeau?
Ben O'Connor, all the way from Western Australia to the Alps in France, is going to put an entertaining end to what has been the most entertaining of opening weeks you are ever likely to see. Cavendish makes it 33 with another chapter to the fairy tale. We are back, it is back, and Mont Ventoux plays host again.
It had to be somebody that would go for it, and Vingegaard it is. So much bad luck has rained down on Jumbo-Visma, but there is light, and this man has just ignited it.
Niels Pollard is a Tour de France stage winner.
Here comes Mark Carriage. It's coming up to the line. Is he going to get there? Oh, I think he has. I think he has done it. He has got there.
But Mark, I mean, have you realised that you've won 34 stages on the Tour de France?
It's like my first one. I've won a stage of the Tour de France.
Bauke Mollema has done it again.
Chapeau, sir. That was superb.
The Austrian champion, Patrick Konrad, could drink this all in. He is now a stage winner of the Tour de France. Here goes Tadej Pogacar, racing on instinct with the perfect powers of recovery. He looks every bit the Tour de France dominant winner.
It is all over, you might say. Oh, look at that.
You seem extremely strong, but are you worried about Vingegaard, for instance?
Why should I be?
He's allowing himself a huge smile and the celebrations. He knows he's got it. Today, the name is Mate Mohoric.
One for now to the line, the fastest time. It's 21.19 seconds quicker.
Where's Mark Cavendish in the green, we ask ourselves. And there he is, he's embedded, but it's a long way down. It's retrievable. Mark Cavendish is boxed in here. It looks like it's going to be others. Is he going to retrieve the situation? Oh, it's well found out that makes the steal.
Tadej Pogacar wins the Tour de France again.
Pogacar, Van der Poel, Van Aert, Cavendish, they gave us quite the show last year, didn't they? 2022 has a lot to live up to.
Oh, it will live up to it, Connor. Have faith, my friend. Now, we start in Denmark this year with a fairly short individual time trial to decide the first yellow jersey. We've then got two flat stages that should be bunch sprints, but there are going to be a lot of nervous riders because of the potential crosswinds.
After that, it's over to France for a tricky stage to Dunkirk, and then an even trickier one over the cobbles of Paris-Roubaix on stage five. That is a stage you do not want to miss. Wednesday, the 6th of July.
Put it in your diaries. 2 days later, though, they are onto the deceptively tough ascent of La Planche des Belles Filles, which will give us a really good indication of form, but then the really serious climbing begins in week two. The Col de Galibier comes on stage 11, and it's the highest point of this year's race.
But if there's one stage you simply have to watch, it's the following day, July 14th, Bastille Day, and they're heading back over the Galibier in the opposite directions, then onto the Croix de Fer before a box office finish at Alpe d'Huez. That is going to be a party and a half for the roadside spectators and television viewers. I can't wait for that one.
It is going to be incredible, isn't it? And now after a few transition stages that come after that, we're then into week three and the Pyrenees. And there's the Col d'Aspin, Périgueux, Aubisque and Hautecam that all feature in that final week. Then there's the second of the two individual time trials on the penultimate day before the traditional final stage around the Champs-Élysées in Paris.
Sounds simple, doesn't it?
Sounds very simple when you say it like that, yes.
Pogacar, Roglic, Vinigo, Thomas, Martinez, O'Connor, Vlasov and Mas will be amongst those vying for the GC, whilst Jakobsen, Groenewegen, Philipsen, Merlier, Ewan and Bennett will be fighting for sprint wins.
There's a lot of big name riders, isn't there? Now, unfortunately, it doesn't look like there will be room for Mark Cavendish in the Quickstep Alpha Vinyl squad this year, so he won't be moving ahead of Merckx in the Tour de France stage wins department. Right, on to the big news of 2022, Le Tour de France Femme avec Zwift. We've been waiting for this moment, and it's almost upon us. It's going to start in Paris on Sunday the 24th of July, the day the men's finishes, and this inaugural edition is going to be 8 stages long.
There is some amount of pressure on the sprinters for that opening day, as whoever crosses the line first will not only be bagging themselves a Tour de France stage win, but also the first yellow jersey.
Lorena Vibes will be starting as the outright favourite for that first stage, of course. But then world champion Elisa Balsamo will be looking to turn all of the colours of the rainbow into just one of them, yellow.
That was almost poetic, Dan. But not quite. There's a short uphill kick to the line on stage two into Provins, which could be a much more suited one for the sprinters. A few more lumps and bumps on stage three into Epinay, and then on stage four, we've got gravel.
Or chalk, actually, I think I read it is. as the riders take on four sectors of unpaved roads around the vineyards of the Champagne region, totaling 13 kilometres. It's going to be dramatic, spectacular, and also has the potential to change the shape of the general classification significantly.
Stages 5 and 6 look like they have the potential to end in sprints, but then come two decisive stages. On Saturday, there are three very tough categorised climbs en route to Le Marc Steen, and then for the 8th and final stage on Sunday, the 31st of July, it's the Queen stage, finishing on La Planche de Belfi.
Which will wrap up a whole month of what promises to be incredibly tough but entertaining racing. The question is, who will be wearing the final yellow jersey at the end of that month?
Annemiek van Vleuten?
Probably.
It's tough to look past her, isn't it? She's been by far the best climber in women's cycling for the last few seasons, and I would say she'd be a fitting winner of the race if she achieved it.
Oh, she would. She'd totally be a fitting winner. Marta Cavalli, Demi Vollering and Ashley Moorman-Pashio will be amongst those trying to cause an upset and beat van Vleuten, but I think Avita Music might be able to do that, which would be great for French fans. Watch out too for Marion Voss and Elisa Balsamo, who'll both be looking to put their stamp on this year's race.
Both the men's and women's races will be available live and on demand on GCN Plus, and I can't wait to watch. There are some territory restrictions though, so if you are thinking of subscribing, make sure you check first whether they are available where you are.
Indeed. Right, that's enough from us for the time being. We're going to hand you over now to Christian Prudhomme and Marion Rousse, who took time out of their busy schedules to answer the questions that you, members of the Tour de France Club, had sent in.
Alors non, il ne partira pas chaque année de Paris. On avait vraiment envie que pour cette première édition, ça reste le côté historique, le trait d'union entre la course des hommes et des femmes, évidemment, pour l'histoire, pour tous les symboles qui vont avec. Mais je vous donne rendez-vous au mois d'octobre cette année pour voir le tracé de la nouvelle édition.
Nous travaillons sur trois éditions consécutives du Tour, notamment en termes de grand départ. Et le lieu du grand départ détermine, pas nécessairement là où nous irons, mais en tout cas on sait là où nous n'irons pas. 3500 km la distance du Tour, règle de l'UCI. Autrefois, quand j'étais gamin, les Tours faisaient 4000-4500 km. Ils ont même fait jusqu'à 5700 km dans les années 20. Donc, évidemment que si vous rajoutez ne serait-ce que 500 km à un Tour, bah, vous faites deux régions supplémentaires, etc. Les parcours, la performance de l'année précédente. Il faut bien voir que le parcours du Tour, il est quasiment ficelé au moment où le Tour a lieu, le parcours du Tour de l'année suivante. On peut modifier à la marge, on a reculé un peu, on a un peu ralenti pour que tout ne soit pas fait, qu'on puisse justement à un moment retirer ou rajouter une arrivée au sommet, modifier, arriver après le dernier col, etc., modifier une longueur de contre-la-montre. Mais tout ça est à la marge. Parce qu'en fait, on est obligé d'avancer. Vous savez, le parcours du Tour, il se fait... si on n'a pas bouclé le parcours du Tour complètement au tout début du mois de septembre, il n'y a pas de Tour de France annoncé à la mi-octobre au Palais des Congrès à Paris. Donc, il faut que ce soit anticipé. Pendant le mois d'août, il y a 15 jours du mois d'août où on ne peut pas travailler. La France est plus ou moins à l'arrêt. C'est vrai pour tout. Donc, la semaine qui suit, les 10 jours qui suivent la fin du Tour sont essentiels. Pendant le Tour, je passe des coups de téléphone pour le Tour d'après, je vois des gens pour le Tour d'après, parfois en catimini. On peut avoir des rendez-vous dans un bar ou chez des amis suivant les villes pour aller rencontrer des élus que je fais semblant de saluer à nouveau sur le village du Tour, comme si je ne les avais pas vus 2 heures plus tôt. Mais voilà, donc ça c'est assez drôle d'ailleurs. Et donc on ne peut pas vraiment... Ça ne dépend pas vraiment de la performance de l'année d'avant. Le Tour 2012, par exemple, et nous avions souhaité à l'époque, avec Jean-François Pécheux, mettre en avant des massifs autres que les Alpes et les Pyrénées. C'était la première fois qu'on allait au Grand Colombier, par exemple, la première année de la planche des Belles-Filles. J'avais voulu, je rêvais d'une confrontation entre rouleurs et grimpeurs, au vu de ce qui s'était passé l'année précédente, en 2011, et puis l'année suivante, au départ, il n'y a ni Andy Schleck, ni Alberto Contador. Donc, voilà. Vous pouvez toujours tirer des plans sur la comète, faire du tableau noir, il y a la réalité de la vie qui vous rattrape, mais ce qui est certain, en revanche, c'est que tout ce qu'on peut imaginer sur le Tour, il y a toujours un Tour l'année d'après. Il y a toujours un Tour qui vient. Donc, comme on travaille sur 3 tours d'affilée, on se dit, tiens, par exemple, aujourd'hui, on est donc en 2022, il y a des endroits pour 2025 où je sais où on va aller. Par exemple, en 23, en 24, en 25. D'ores et déjà, aujourd'hui, parce qu'on a calé ça grâce aux liens que nous avons avec les élus, avec les collectivités, qui sont des liens que l'on tisse, que l'on a tissé au quotidien depuis des années et des années, et qui sont absolument essentiels pour le Tour de France.
Beaucoup d'impact. Ça sera d'ailleurs un peu un air de classique ardennaise et flandrienne sur les routes du mois de juillet. Évidemment, ce sera une course très difficile avec pas mal de dénivelé au programme. Mais on sait que sur ce genre de parcours, il faut avoir également la réussite de son côté. Donc un vecteur chance qui fait aussi la beauté des classiques. Donc évidemment, ça aura un impact sur le classement général.
Je me souviens évidemment de la première fois où je suis allé sur les bords sur la route du Tour, à l'initiative de mon père, en famille, avec mon frère et ma sœur, avec mes parents. C'était au col de Coux, qui est en Haute-Savoie, qui est juste à côté du lac Léman où nous étions en vacances. Je crois que l'étape arrivait de Divonne. J'avais été très heureux de voir le maillot jaune. Eddy Merckx est hyper déçu de ne pas reconnaître, dans un peloton qui était pourtant moins important qu'aujourd'hui, celui qui m'a donné l'amour du Tour et qui s'appelait Raymond Poulidor, dont le petit-fils Mathieu Van Der Poel nous enchante et j'espère nous enchantera encore sur les routes du Tour comme il l'a fait l'année dernière. Donc voilà, c'est un moment inoubliable, c'est un moment évidemment, moi je suis arrivé, j'ai aimé le Tour notamment grâce à la radio. À l'époque, il n'y avait pas tout à la télé, il y avait les 15 ou 20 derniers kilomètres à la télévision, c'est tout. Dans la fin des années 60, début des années 70. En revanche, à la radio, on avait les 100 derniers kilomètres en intégralité et on pouvait passer autrement d'une station de radio à l'autre. Et on rêvait, en fait. La radio, c'est le média du rêve. Donc, quand un de vos favoris passe en tête au sommet du col, vous vous dites, pourvu qu'il reste en tête en bas, après la descente, pourvu qu'il ne tombe pas, etc. Vous imaginez un tas de scénarios, de scénarii. Et c'est ça qui m'a donné assurément l'amour du Tour. Donc oui, non, je n'ai pas oublié le passage au col de Coux en 1970 et je l'oublierai jamais.
Ça remonte à loin, parce que pour tout vous dire, j'étais encore dans la poussette, que j'étais déjà sur le bord des routes pour le Tour de France et aller encourager les coureurs. Donc le premier souvenir, je pense que je vais avoir 5 ou 6 ans, le Tour de France passait dans le Nord. Et comme tous les enfants, j'étais venue pour aller à la chasse au bidon, aller récupérer et aller faire signer des autographes à tous les grands champions. Et le soir, je me souviens que j'allais prendre mon vélo et je m'identifiais aux champions de l'époque et j'avais l'impression de revivre les derniers kilomètres. C'était quelque chose de magique et je pense que les enfants d'aujourd'hui vivent la même chose.
La France est tellement belle et il y a tellement de lieux magnifique ou mythique sur le Tour. L'une de nos obsessions, l'une de mes obsessions, c'est de faire en sorte de garder les mythes d'aujourd'hui, l'Alpe d'Huez, le Ventoux, le Tourmalet, le Galibier, de remettre au goût du jour peut-être certains cols ou lieux de légende qui ont perdu un peu de leur force. Je pense notamment à l'Isoard, qui est un lieu absolument extraordinaire, avec la casse déserte, avec les exploits de Bobet, Copie, d'Eddy Merckx. Et c'est pour ça qu'il y a eu l'arrivée de 2017, avec la victoire de Warren Barguil. Et puis d'aller chercher de nouveaux lieux. Alors les nouveaux lieux, ils sont évidemment en montagne, je pense au col de la Lauze, à la planche des Belles-Filles, au Grand Colombier, au col du Portet, mais ils sont aussi en plaine. Ces murs de Bretagne, c'est la mise en avant à nouveau des pavés, c'est aller chercher des choses qui n'existent pas ou qu'on n'a pas vu, qui existent mais qu'on n'a pas encore vu sur le Tour de France. Voilà. Puis par exemple, au chapitre sportif et plus encore esthétique, les lacets de Montdernier. Hein, on était passé des années et des années, des dizaines d'années, un demi-siècle devant sans faire attention. Le fait que les coureurs puissent passer, en changeant de doctrine pour nous aussi, parce que pendant longtemps, il fallait que tout passe, y compris la caravane. Et ce qu'on fait désormais, c'est qu'on veut à certains moments rendre la montagne aux champions. Bah, si la caravane ne passe pas, s'il y a 10 km sur 3500 où il n'y a pas la caravane, eh bien, on le fait. D'ailleurs, il n'y a personne d'autre que les coureurs, en dehors de ce qu'on appelle l'échelon course dans les lacets de Montvernier. Il n'y a pas de spectateurs non plus, parce qu'autrement, on ne pourrait tout simplement pas faire passer la course. Voilà. Donc ça, c'est pour moi quelque chose de très très important. Donc, voilà. On a la chance d'avoir un pays absolument magnifique, nos campagnes, nos montagnes, le littoral. Pays limitrophes aussi, on en profite avec les prises de vue dominantes qui sont celles de l'hélicoptère et qui magnifient sans aucun doute les exploits des champions.
C'est la question qu'on me pose le plus souvent. Je pense que déjà partir sur une course par étape de 8 étapes et bien la faire, c'était notre priorité parce qu'on n'a pas envie dans 3 ans de se dire que ça n'a pas marché et qu'on arrête tout. Nous, on a vraiment vocation à être présente sur le long terme, que dans 100 ans, cette course existe toujours. Et donc, on a envie surtout que ce système marche, qu'on trouve un équilibre aussi financier et que par la suite, évidemment, on ne s'interdise pas à ce que le Tour de France soit plus long. En tout cas, je pousserai derrière.
Puis de Dôme 64, j'adore l'Alpe, j'adore Copie. Mais le 12 juillet 64, puisqu'il y a eu des 12 juillet avant le 12 juillet 98 et la première victoire de la France en Coupe du Monde de foot, indépendamment de l'anniversaire de ma femme, mais c'est pas la peine de lui envoyer un bouquet, ou l'anniversaire de Lionel Jospin, ancien Premier ministre, 12 juillet 64, que je n'ai pas vécu, mais voilà, c'est le mythe, la fameuse photo. Regardez, ne bougez pas. Voilà, la fameuse photo en noir et blanc, 12 juillet 64, le bouquin de Blondin, c'est juste à côté dans la bibliothèque, dans mon bureau. Voilà, c'est un moment absolument phénoménal, épaule contre épaule, c'est la légende du vélo, c'est le noir et blanc, c'est l'histoire du Tour. Il faut se souvenir du Tour. Il faut penser à demain, il faut penser à l'avenir. Mais il ne faut jamais oublier d'où on vient. Jamais, jamais, jamais. Parce que sans ces gens-là, sans ces champions-là, le Tour ne serait pas ce qu'il est. Mer 69. Eddy, c'est avant le fameux accident, un tragique accident de Blois, la chute d'Eddy et la mort de son entraîneur à l'époque. Bah, c'est Mourinx, hein, évidemment. C'est Eddy qui, à un kilomètre du sommet du Tourmalet, attaque pour passer en tête. Il est fou d'avoir appris la veille que Martin Van den Bosch, son lieutenant, va changer d'équipe. Donc il se dit, allez, j'y vais. Col de Bisque, 140 km. Il arrive avec une avance insensée de 8 minutes. Et c'est la légende du Tour de France. Merci à Mourinx, c'est les mots de Léon Zitrone, qui était donc la star, la vedette de la télévision française et de la radio à l'époque. Qui dit, vous êtes un seigneur, monsieur Merckx, vous êtes un seigneur. Il l'est toujours. J'étais très heureux pour les gens de Mourinx qu'Eddy accepte de venir lorsqu'on a fait l'étape la dernière fois. Il y avait d'ailleurs un clip sur les réseaux sociaux qui était hyper bien foutu avec un jeune gamin sur son vélo à Mourinx et les clameurs et le commentaire de Zitrone à l'époque. Voilà, donc 69. Contre la montre individuelle, je préfère la définition du sport individuel qui se court par équipe. Planche des Belles Filles 2020, c'était formidable, mais forcément, dans la légende du Tour de France, les Champs-Élysées 89, après un tour fou entre Laurent Fignon et Greg LeMond, et Fignon qui perd le maillot jaune au tout dernier moment pour 8 secondes sur les Champs-Élysées, c'est juste inoubliable. Je ne vais pas faire le tri ou choisir dans les champions du Tour. J'en côtoie certains, je n'ai pas connu Jacques Anquetil, j'ai la chance de voir régulièrement Bernard Hinault et Eddy Merckx, mais voilà, ils font partie tous les quatre. Assurément de la légende du Tour. C'est copyright Prudhomme, c'est une formule que j'emploie souvent en 3500 km de sourire. Il m'est arrivé de dire cette ville parce que c'est de part et d'autre de la route, les 3500 km, la distance du Tour. En tout cas, ce qui est certain, c'est que la dimension sociale du Tour de France est essentielle. Le Tour, c'est la plus grande course cycliste du monde, ce sont des champions, bien sûr, demain des champions, à nouveau. C'est la beauté des paysages, la diversité de nos paysages, la découverte de la France, la redécouverte de la France des pays limitrophes. Mais c'est aussi du lien social, ce qu'on voit moins. Ce que l'on voit quand on est vraiment dans le Tour et qu'on avance pendant les 3 semaines de juillet, c'est juste phénoménal. Les sourires partout, les gamins, les anciens, les femmes, les hommes, les Français, les étrangers. C'est un moment de bonheur, c'est un moment d'insouciance dans un monde qui peut être parfois bien compliqué. Donc, j'adore ça, j'adore le Tour pour toutes ces dimensions-là.
Mur. Ascension. Plus spectaculaire par équipe, mais individuelle quand même. Ouais, je suis une fille du Nord, pavé. Étape course. Les deux sont très difficiles. Pour la sécurité des coureurs, quand même, la chaleur. Désolée, mais il faut plat montant vendre dehors. Pour la course, c'est mieux. Ouais, super planche. Un Tour de France femme avec Zwift épique, avec un changement de maillot jaune chaque jour, et remporté par les Françaises.
Fantastic, and you'll be seeing the heads of Christian and Marion poking out the sunroof of Skoda in just a few weeks as they wave the riders off at kilometre zero each day. Now I'm going to pose a couple of quick fire questions now to you, Connor. Please try to make them a little bit snappier in terms of answers than Christian just there. First up, individual time trial or team time trial?
Team time trial.
Champs-Élysées 1989 or La Planche des Belles Filles 2020?
Planche des Belles Filles 2020.
Okay, Anquetil, Merckx, Indurain or Eno?
I'm going for Indurain, fellow big rider.
Yes,
in terms of stature.
Champagne or red wine?
Red wine.
I think I'd go with you on that one. Jakobsen or Cavendish?
You've got to go Cavendish, I think. History.
I don't want to answer that one. And finally, Vos or Van Vleuten?
I said that's the hardest of the lot. I think I'd go Vos.
Well, there's no right or wrong answer.
That's true.
Connor, that said, I'm not going to give an answer. Too hard to choose.
Oh, okay, well, there you go. Now, those of you who are already members of the Tour de France Club will be well aware of the benefits, but if you're watching this and considering becoming a member, we thought we'd let you know what you'll get.
Exclusive videos from in and around the Tour de France, access to race radio so that you can find out what's going on out there on the road that often isn't captured by television cameras. Beyond that, you will also be able to enter a whole host of exclusive competitions with prizes such as VIP trips to the race, as well as voting to decide the most combative rider of each and every stage.
So if you're not signed up, why not? It's free of charge. You just need to head to letour.fr.
Indeed. I actually signed up to the Tour de France Club last year purely for access to race radio, which is very useful and also very insightful.
It's pretty cool.
Right, we're going to move on now. What big race preview in cycling in 2022 would be complete without a stat attack from the one, the only, Killian Kelly?
Most of them, but we've got one for you anyway. Over to you, Killian.
The Tour de France is always the best race to dig around for cycling facts and stats because the entire racing calendar revolves around it. So let's start with the basics. Four riders share the record for the most number of Tour wins. Five, which has been done by Jacques Anquetil, Eddie Merckx, Bernardino and Miguel Indurain, with Indurain the only one of the four who won his consecutively. Chris Froome could join that list this year, although it seems unlikely. Tadej Pogacar has the chance to win his third Tour de France, having already won the race each time he's taken part in it. The only rider to have won their first three Tours de France before was Eddie Merckx. Having also finished on the podium of the Vuelta on his Grand Tour debut in 2019, Pogacar could also end up finishing on the podium of his first four Grand Tours. Only two other riders have done this, and for once, they don't include Eddie Merckx. They were Alfredo Binda and Bernard Hinault, who won his first four Grand Tours. Pogacar also belongs on another exclusive list alongside Bernard Hinault. Of all the riders who have started more than one edition of the Tour, there are three who have worn the yellow jersey every time they've taken part. Pog in the two he's won so far, Hinault in all eight editions he took part in, which is truly mind-boggling, and the third rider was the German fastman Rudi Altig, who did the same in four different editions in the 1960s. The Tour this year, of course, starts in Denmark. This will be the 24th occasion in the 109 editions of the race when we've had a Grand Départ outside of France, and it will be the furthest north the Tour has ever started, but also the furthest north the Tour has ever been. Alp d'Huez makes a glorious return to the route on stage 12 this year. The Tour's most famous climb is back on the menu after a hiatus of 4 years, since Geraint Thomas won there in the yellow jersey in 2018, the only rider ever to do so. 4 years is the longest gap between trips up the Alp since the first two times it was in the Tour, in 1952 when the stage was won by Fausto Coppi and 1976 when Joep Zoetemelk conquered the Alp. The stage is a carbon copy of the one which appeared on the route of the 1986 Tour, starting in Briançon, going over the Galibier, the Col de la Croix de Fer, and finishing atop Alp d'Huez. That was the famous stage where Bernard Hinault and Greg LeMond crossed the line arm in arm, with Hinault taking the stage honours. Hinault, of course, remains the last French rider to win the Tour de France. Or is he? This year we have the Tour de France Femmes avec Zwift to look forward to. Eight stages starting on the Champs-Élysées as the men's race finishes on the Champs-Élysées. But this actually won't be the first incarnation of an ASO-organised women's Tour de France. The Tour de France Féminin was organised between 1984 and 1989, the last winner of which, in fact, the winner of the last three editions, was the French great, the longevous Ginny Longo, who could say she won the Tour de France 4 years after Bernard Hinault won his final edition in 1985.
Now, if you like stats as much as we do, then you can get more of them from Killian on the World of Cycling on GCN+, the weekly show that brings you the inside line on bike racing every week.
But Killian is no longer just a stat nerd. He's turned himself into a proper cyclist.
I'm not sure I'd go quite that far, Connor, but he is training hard at the moment in preparation for L'Étape du Tour. That will take place on the 10th of July over the same route as stage 12 of the Tour de France, which, as you remember, finishes up Alpe d'Huez.
Nothing like throwing yourself in at the deep end, is there? Although he'll be thankful that the modern stages of the Tour de France are nothing like as long as they once were.
On the 19th of July, 1903, on the opening leg of the first Tour de France, 60 riders made history by leaving Paris, their destination, Lyon. 116 years on, two riders recreated that original stage.
I have always wanted to do an ultra-endurance ride.
Are you any good at ultra-endurance?
No.
60k hour on a 100-year-old bike. So I'm going.
We need to get this fixed pretty quickly, otherwise I'm going to have to crack on load.
I've just never ridden up a hill on a fixed gear like this. Fundamentally, it's the wrong gear. This is into the graveyard shift proper.
It was like my knees were about to explode.
Bottom bracket just started to seize.
I don't know if we can get it going again.
By far, my toughest single ride ever. For the guys who came in first, I can't understand how they did that.
Waves of dizziness and a little bit of nausea are hitting me.
Without doubt, the stupidest thing I've ever done.
It's a test, isn't it?
My hands are quite sore. My saddle is really uncomfortable. I've also got a nail rather close to my...
It's quite hard to fathom how they used to be able to ride 400-kilometre stages, given the road surface at the time, and indeed the bikes that they had access to back in those days, isn't it?
Yeah, fair play to Mark Beaumont and Hank for getting through just one of those stages from the 1903 Tour de France. If you'd like to see the full documentary, you can find it on GCN Plus.
And a reminder, just before we finish, that you can get GCN Plus at a 25% discount if you're a member of the Tour de France Club and in one of our 14 eligible territories. So it's well worth signing up if that applies to you.
It definitely is. But thanks everyone for watching. If you'd like a much more in-depth Tour de France preview show, we'll have one for the men's coming out soon and the women's one around 5 days before they start their event on the 24th of July.
So all that leaves us to say is thanks for watching and enjoy the Tours de France this time around. We'll see you soon.